So, welcome Irina Kogan from NC State, and she will give a talk on differential algebra of invariants and invariant variational calculus.
That's right. So, a lot of invariants in the title. And first of all, I'd like to thank Alexei for organizing the session, for inviting me here. And I would start with a glimpse in actually the second part of this title, invariant variational calculus, as one of the areas where differential algebra of invariants is applied. So I'll start with a glimpse into invariant variational calculus. And I brought some probes. And so the first problem which you would consider, this is a thin strip. And it's considered to be a very thin, so the width is negligible. And what we do, the length is fixed, so it's not stretchable, but it's bendable. And we fix the endpoints, and we fix the tangents at the endpoints. And the question is, what shape does it take? And here, so this is a probe. So it is actually a picture of the mechanism, which was made by Max Born, who is well known for his work in quantum mechanics, so well known that he received a Nobel Prize. But this was his PhD thesis, where he studied stability of this problem if you vary the endpoint conditions. And there is a very nice article. The problem is called elastica. Also, the bend is not changing its length. It's elastic in the sense that it is bendable. And there is a very nice paper, historical, about history of this problem. And I will not talk about stability, but I will talk about variational representation of this problem. And variational representation is due to Bernoulli, and later was used together to really compute a lot of solutions for this problem. And that's why oftentimes it's called Euler's elastica, but he used a lot of results of Bernoulli. And so what does it mean we formulate it as a variational problem? So the shape which this curve would take, so it has this curve, so the shape which is, let's take it first as a parameterized curve, so the shape which it would take would minimize bending energy. What is bending energy? So kappa here is Euclidean curvature, which is written explicitly here in terms of x and y, and dots represent derivative with respect to parameter t. And ds is Euclidean arc length. So to find, so what was discovered by Bernoulli is that the shape, the curve x of t, y of t, and in this situation we consider this problem on the plane, right? You can consider this problem on the plane and in space, this is in the plane, would be such that this is minimal. Now, another feature of this problem is that it is invariant with respect to rigid motion. If I apply rigid motion to my boundary condition, then the solution of my new problem is just the same rigid motion applied to the solution of my previous problem. That means that this problem is invariant with respect to rigid motions. And this is manifested here that it is written with respect to Euclidean invariants, right? Curvature is invariant with respect to rigid motions. Arc length is invariant with respect to rigid motions. Now, if we would like to minimize something, like you know, if I would like to find the minimum of a function in calculus, right? What do we do usually? Any calculum suggestion? Take a derivative, look for zeros, right? The same happens in variational calculus. But the thing is, you're not, when you do it in calculus, you look for a number, for a value of x. Now you look for a, in general, a function, but you still take a variational derivative. And here, to take a variational derivative, I had to rewrite my problem in coordinates. And here I decided to have a little bit less variable, so I assume that my gamma is parameterized with x. So x and u of x. So this is my functional. For every function u of x, I get some value. Now, here x is denote derivative with respect to x. U of x, so a little bit different notation. And yet I will later use even short annotation, I will replace this subscripts of x with the corresponding indices. So the formula should look shorter. So how do I take variational derivative? Well, the function which stays inside integral is often called Lagrangian, denoted here by n. And standard well-known variational calculus by now says I need to apply this operator, which is in this bracket, in this box, and I'll get something, and this would be fourth-order differential equation, and the solutions of this equation would be critical points. So similarly, like in usual calculus, places where derivative is zero, it's not necessary an extremum, but it provides a critical value, a necessary condition for extremum. The same here. So if I look to minimize this, I need to solve these equations, which I usually call Euler Lagrange equations. So let us look at this operator a little bit more closely. There are two. So I write it as an infinite sum, because in general, my Lagrangian could depend on derivatives of any order. It's not first order Lagrangian. It could be second derivative, third derivative. But of course, finitely many derivatives. So this sum would always terminate in some order. I mean, this, it terminates at order 2, the highest derivative I could take with respect to u2. Now, these are partial derivatives. When I take them, I forget that u is a function of x, right? In calculus variation, you just treat it as new variables. These are total derivative, right? When I take this total derivative, I remember that u is a function of x, and I start to apply chain rule. And so if you do everything correctly, you get this equation, and you need to solve it to find candidates for minimum of this function. All right, but not surprisingly, this equation is also symmetric with respect to the group of Richard Moschaft. And this is always the case. Your Euler-Lagrange equation always inherits symmetries of your variational problem. And so you can also rewrite them in terms of Euclidean invariance. And here, curvature is the same Euclidean curvature. Kappa SS, what is this? We have DS. And we have a corresponding differential operator which takes actually invariant to invariant, and we can differentiate this respect to it. Okay, so this is a little bit related, but a different instance of what George was talking about. Once you have some symmetry, you can rewrite your equations in terms of invariance, and they usually looks nicer and shorter. The same happening here in some sense. Also, this is a very different example of this. So the question which you would like to ask, well, this is a nice formula. This is a nice formula. Is there anything which take me from here to here directly? Well, the first temptation to answer this question which you would have is to say, well, why not we treat now that kappa is a function of s, right? And apply just the same operator, which with u replaced by kappa and dtx replaced by this dtx. Well, it's very easy to see that there is no derivative of kappa which involves here. And so the only term I would have is dt kappa, right? But dt kappa, just partial derivative of kappa, will produce kappa in this case, and it's not that equation. So this is not a right operator. So So one of the points of my talk is to show what is the right operator. But I'll keep a suspense for a little bit and show some other nice examples of where this appears. So this is an example from the paper which appeared in Nature Materials by Starostin and van der Heijden. Where exactly machinery of invariant variational calculus was used. And now also, they have a very nice picture, but I also brought some probes here. So again, you have a strips of bendable material, but now its width is not negligible. It has some width, and it has some fixed width, which is actually 2W is width, and it has some length. And you make the strip and you bend it into an inverse strip, right? And again, you would like to describe the shape. What is the shape? It would depend on the lengths and the widths of these things. All right. It turns out you can completely determine the shape if you know the center line. What is the center? What center line is, and what is the width? And again, it's a variational problem. And again, it's a Euclidean invariant variational problem, but now in the space. So now you have two basic invariants, curvature and torsion. And you can, and DS is again your invariant differential operator. So this is exactly a variational problem which you would like to minimize. Here it's actually sets that 2W is the width of the string, kappa is Euclidean curvature, and tau is the torsion. And you can imagine that if you start to rewrite it in the original coordinate, it would be a huge formula. And to apply, then finding other Lagrange equations and solving them would be very demanding. It's actually a pretty big formula if you do it even in this setting. And to solve these equations, the authors applied numerical methods to this invariant Euler Lagrange equations. Now here's a simple example and a very classical one. This example is when you fix a boundary in a closed boundary curve in three-dimensional space, and you are looking for a surface with minimal area, right? Very well-known geometric problem. And what you want to minimize, well, if your surface is given as a graph, z is u of x, y, this is infinitesimal area, which is Euclidean invariant, and you just want to minimize it. So if I try to write it in an invariant way, I have to use differential invariants and invariant forms. But this is my invariant form. So my Lagrangian is actually 1 here. And so this is like non-invariant approach, and this problem doesn't lead to huge formulas. So if I do it with n equal to in my original coordinates, this would be my corrected Euler Lagrange operator, and I get this equation. This formula here is nothing else as mean curvature, so we recover well-known results that I'm looking for a surface with zero mean curvature. The question is, what operator will applied to 1 would produce mean curvature. So now I'm ready to show the answers for this question. And actually, in the examples, in the instances which I showed before with my example, mainly for Euclidean group acting on curves and surfaces on the plane and in R3, the answer was given by Griffiths and Anderson, but by somewhat ad hoc methods. So what we did with Peter Rocker, we found a general formula in any dimension, so you could have q unknown function of p variables, and you can have an arbitrary Lie group acting there, so not necessarily Richard motions. This is completely algorithmic. I have written IVP package. IVP stands for, I stands for invariant, and VV stands for variational bicomplex. So variational bicomplex is a very nice bicomplex of differential forms where you can represent very nicely express many aspects of variational calculus. So we constructed invariant version of this variational bicomplex, and in this context we obtain these formulas, but I will not talk about invariant variational bicomplex, I will just show the result. So this package was using a package ratio for calculus on the jet bundles, which was written by Jan Andersen and his colleagues. So now this package, it became prototype of what is now a standard MAPL package, differential geometry package. And now I finally got some time to rewrite my package to work well with the differential geometry package. So I'm working on that right now, and hopefully soon it could be more usable, because this all now is a little bit hard to find and to use. So now I promise to show the solution of the problem. So I will return to the planar case, but with an arbitrary group. And let kappa be a low total differential invariant, which we could call G curvature, like analog of Euclidean curvature. Ds is a low total G invariant 1 form, so it's invariant differential form, which we can call G arc length. And dual to any invariant differential forms, there would be invariant differential operator, which is G invariant derivative, which would be the scalar graphic D. And we can then apply this operator to most of the invariant and obtain a univariant. So this is in general how G-symmetric variational problem looks like. And you can see this counterparts that kappa sort of plays a role of U, ds plays a role of dx, and this d plays a role of total derivative. D is called invariant total derivative. There is some caution which has to be taken here. Everyone which is familiar with arc lengths knows that it is not a real variable. Because to determine arc lengths, you need to start with some initial point and integrate, right? So it's not a local variable. It is manifested in another way that it's a little bit misleading to write ds for arc lengths, because in exterior differential calculus, dds should be zero, d squared is zero. But of course, it's not true for arc lengths. And this is one of the very high naive approach for deriving invariant Laplace operator doesn't work. All right, so how is correct invariant Laplace operator would look like? It would be actually a composition of several differential variables, differential operators. This piece here is sort of analog of the standard Euler Lagrange operator in the standard coordinate. We were treating kappa as mu unknown function, and d is a total derivative. We have another piece which sort of analog of Hamiltonian, and there is a small remark which I already made. If for some group it happens that S is a local variable equivalently DDS and zero, then this part will be not here at all. So one of the complications comes from that arc lengths, and for other groups the analog is not a real variable. There are also two differential operators which are measuring infinitesimal variation of the base of the generating invariant and the arc lengths in normal directions, which is normal, is not Euclidean normal, but I will not have time to describe it. What is important is that A and B algorithmically computable from the structure equation of an invariant coframe, and I hope I will have some time to talk about it a little bit. Another thing which I would like to mention that E and H, they would be the same no matter what group is acting. What will change is A and B. So A and B we need to compute for every group action, but it could be done algorithmically, as I mentioned. Now, this is the answer for skillful planar curves. And very similar formula would take place if you have Q unknown function of P variables, but my operator, instead of being scalar operator, becomes vector or matrix operator. So everything in this formula would be just the same formula, just with objects of higher dimensions. So this is an example to illustrate what would be the formulas for different groups, still now in planar case. So I already showed that for Euclidean group, we have our familiar curvature, our familiar clans. This is how A and B would look like. I forgot to mention the stars. Stars means a joint operator. And in the case of the Euclidean groups, these operators are self-adjoint, which you can easily check. If we apply affine group, what is the difference between affine group and a Euclidean group? In a Euclidean group, what is a Euclidean group? It's rotation, reflections, and translations. So they involve orthogonal matrix and translations. Affine group allows any linear transformation with determinant 1 and translations. So invariants would look different. Your sort of affine arc lengths would look very different. an operator saying B would be looking different, but they all are going to be computed. Let me quickly show, I promise, I said that it is generalized for multidimensional case, so I will just show what happens with curves in R3. Again, it could be any group action, and you have analog of G-curvature and G-torsion. Your variational problem would look like this. It would be some functional of kappa and its derivative and tau and its derivative integrated with respect to arc lengths, which is arc lengths for this group. Again, your Euler Lagrange operator will have the same form, but now you see E becomes a vector operator. And if we take, say, going to Euclidean group, we will compute A and B. This becomes a matrix, this becomes a vector. So things just gain the dimension if you have multidimensional problem, but they have the same shape in general shape. So whether we do like symmetry, the process we have was shown is called symmetry reduction. And whether we do symmetry reduction or symmetry analysis of either variational problem or differential equations, differential invariants, invariant differential functions, invariant differential forms, invariant vector fields, or invariant differential operators will play a very important role. You will compute things in terms of them. And you could be interested in these things in designing algorithms for the balancing set. First of all, you might want to compute explicit formulas for invariants. On the other hand, these formulas may be very difficult, and you would like to know how much structure you can deduce without explicit formulas. And in fact, a lot of things could be done without explicit formulas. And now you really need some procedures to do, say, write invariant Euler Lagrange operator, or do some other things related to solving equations or doing variational calculus. I have actually almost the same number of slides devoted to kind of going in more details in each of these categories, and I don't know where I started and how much time do I have now. What do you say?
7 minutes.
Okay, so I'll try to see what I can say. So first of all, we can discuss in what category we are working, right? And I think when it comes to symmetry analysis of differential equations or variational problems, there is two almost disjoint body of literature with a very little bridges between them, also some bridges exist. So there is a large body of literature which deals with smoothly groups or even more general notion of pseudogroups, acting on smooth manifold, an action is a smooth map, probably a local map, and invariants are local and smooth. There is another body of literature which deals, and this is kind of done in the realm of differential geometry. And there is another body of literature which is doing algebraic geometry or algebraic approach to the same problem, dealing with algebraic groups, algebraic variety, polynomial or rational actions, and rational or maybe algebraic invariants. And it is interesting when these areas come into interplay, because I think a lot of things could be translated between two of these words and kind of fit to each other. Another thing, even if this is a smooth category, something could be done algorithmically even in a smooth category. So computing explicit formulas. So this is the first item which was on the agenda. How do we do it? So I will show first a construction by, in a smooth category, by Felsen Auger from 1999, which actually builds on a work of many differential geometers, starting with Kaftan, Chorn, Griffiths, Green, Jensen, I probably don't mention everyone involved. But they made a very nice and in a way simple to understand and general procedure. So we have a group acting on some manifold, and the action is locally free. What does it mean locally free? that means that the dimension of the orbit is equal to the dimension of the groups. Orbit, for people who forgot what it is, I start with a point and I take my group, and whenever it takes me, this would be the orbit. And so what's the first thing which we do? We choose a cross-section. And this is a formal definition, but I'm just showing the picture. I would like something which intersects each orbit transversally and would be of complementary dimension, in particular, and will intersect each orbit only once. So this is what I would do in an ideal world. In reality, even locally, you might not be able to do it. So that's why this construction is local. First of all, we do it locally. And even locally, I cannot always guarantee that my orbit intersects only once. Maybe it goes somewhere far away and comes back, right? And so as a result of this, I will construct what is called local invariance, but I will not get into the details. So you can just imagine ideal situations that this intersects each orbit only once. So what I do, once I choose the cross sections, and from every point, I would find a group element which would bring me to the cross-section. And in the ideal world, it would be a unique element, and assertion of locally free reactions, there would be only finitely many of such elements. So what do? Algebraically, I solve for some equations to find the group parameters which bring me here. And then I have my transformation formula, say it's for functions, form of vector fields, and I just substitute. And this gives me invariance. And this is called invariantization, which will be denoted by your term, which corresponds to this cross-section. And in the black here, if you can see black, this step is non-constructive. When it is required to solve some equations, this is even an algebraic setting, that would be non-constructive. But in many situations, you can do it, like in this situation, which I will show to illustrate. This is a simple action on the plane, just rotation, right? It is described by this equation. Rotation is described by this equation. X and Y is my coordinates on the plane, capital X and Y, where they get translated by rotation. I choose a cross section, which is a positive y-axis. And this is a perfect cross section, because each orbit intersects at once. So here we're in a perfect world. And I look for, I am at the point Z, which has coordinates x, y, and I look for a rotation which will bring me to positive y-axis, actually. So I will solve the equations that this capital X is equal to 0 and y is greater than 0. So here are my solutions. And I don't need really phi, I need only cosine and sine. So my method said, okay, just substitute it into the my equation for my group transformation, and you would get invariance. So to check if not everyone is already sleeping, what happens if I substitute these things in the formula for x, capital X? And this is a hint. Yeah, it would be zero. This is what I was solving. But if I substitute this for formula for y, what you will get is radius, right? So geometrically, it's very simple. My invariant is y coordinate of the point on this x, y-axis, it's radius, right? So this is my invariant, radius. It's wonderful. I can do the same trick with differential forms, right? This is how differential form is dx is an example of differential form, and just applying d to this formula, here it how it transforms. If I substitute now this cosine and sine, I get this form, which is invariant. It's actually d phi, right? And this is dr. So this works. All right. So some property of this invariantization. It is a projection. If I invertize something twice, I'll get the same thing, which is nice. Oops. Now, recall here, I was invariantizing transformation of coordinates. The result is what is called normalized invariance. And this normalized invariance has this very nice replacement property which George mentioned in his example, to rewrite any invariant in terms of normalized invariance. I just need to substitute coordinates with the invariantization. And actually, this is more general formula. If I would like to invariantize any function, I can. It is f of invariantization of coordinates. And so this is very nice properties. And also, invariantization preserves linear independence of vector fields and differential forms. That is also very nice. If I invariantize a basis of differential form, I have invariant basis of differential forms. So these are very nice properties. Now, as I said, there was non-algorithmic construction step of solving equation. And in fact, we first solve equations and then substitute. Then any, like from algebraic point of view, what is this? It's elimination, right? And then what we did in a joint work with Evelyn Hubert, we gave an algebraic counterpart for this construction. And it is actually global algebraic counterpart of this construction, which is a byproduct produces a generating set of rational invariants, and also we find sort of algebraic counterparts on normalized invariants. We can drop local freeness assumption, but if we would like to, this procedure wouldn't work if we would like to invariantize by this method a differential form of vector fields. There are other methods to find invariant vector fields and differential forms, but this particular analog for smooth construction would not work. And if we would like to invariantize vector fields and differential forms, we still need this local freeness. But for function, there is a global algebraic construction. I had an example, but I'll probably skip it. I'll show some example, because my example with rotation, my invariants were not differential, right? Just I'll quickly show a differential invariance, and then it would be probably a Luma stop. So we start with this group action, which is now a combination of rotation and translation. And now I assume that I'm not just acting on the plane, but I'm acting on curves of the plane. Right? And so my curve is actually u of f of x. And I'd like to find, once I have an action on curves, I act on the derivatives, right? And how do I compute action on derivatives? By the chain rule, right? So I take du dx, right? This would be transformation for the first derivative, then to the second, and so forth. So in a fancy language, what we are doing here, we are prolonging action to the gen bundle of curves in R2. But in simple words, we just apply a chain rule. I would like also to mention that this action wasn't locally free because I have three group parameters, dimension is three, and the plane is just of dimension two, so it cannot be locally free, but once I lift it a little bit just for the first prolongation, it's locally free. So again, I choose a cross section, x is equal to zero, u is equal to zero, ux is equal to zero. So I would need to solve this equation for group parameters, which I do. I do my substitution. And I start to get invariant. So this is how we recover our curvatures. The next one is its derivatives. The next one is not quite second derivative, but some combination of second derivative and curvature. We do differential forms. We don't quite recover ds, but we recover ds with some other form, which is called theta. Theta has a very nice formula property. It's du minus ux dx. If u is actually f of x, then this theta is zero, because du would be ux dx. So this is what's called contact forms. And that by ds is not truly actually invariant form, but when it is restricted to the graph of any curve, it's this part is zero, actually. Okay, and just for fun, we invariantize a contact form, and we get again a contact form, which is actually also very important. Okay, so there are some, let me like have two more slides probably. So this one slide is, there are very important general things which is going to be underscored by this example. First of all, the prolonged action becomes locally free on a jet bundle of finite order, at least on an open subset. Invertization of contact forms would be always again a contact form, which is actually important if you do work on jet bundle. And differential algebra of invariance is finitely generated. This is an old theorem, but there are certain more constructive version of this theorem and also certain algebraic version of this theorem, which I wanted to mention. Now what I would like to show, I will not show this result completely, but we also, what I mentioned a structure, that we can compute structure of exterior differential algebra. So let me just quickly mention what do I mean by this. So let's say I have a basis of differential form here, right? So what is exterior differential calculus? It's operation on differential form. So I take exterior derivative and I get some of one form, I will get a two form. And these are some functions. So this is called structure equations. If I have a dual differential operators, then the commutative relationship is described with the negative sign by the same functions. So these are called structure functions. Assume, as I mentioned, I start to invertize everything, right? And I showed that if I invertize, I get a gain invariant basis. So what I would like to do, I would like to know what would be D of invariant counterpart of this, right? This is now invariant. What would be this coefficient? So the naive way would say, well, just invariantize this. This doesn't work, but we can algorithmically compute what it would be, these coefficients. They are not just invariantization of this, but they are some computable in this formula. And you can compute this without knowing explicit formulas. So this is important. Just by knowing a cross-section with which you consider. So this is an important point. So you don't need explicit formula, you just need to know the equation of cross-section to compute this commutative relationship, and the same similar then it would be for invariant differential operators. So the last thing which I would like to show is maybe to talk about software which is available. This was slide B. So this is wonderful, and most of them I already mentioned. So this is differential geometry package, which very nice package, not necessarily for symmetry reduction, but for doing any computation in differential geometry, jet bundles, Lie groups. In particular, it has a procedure called moving frames, which compute explicit invertization. There is my package, which I now actually jointly with Ian try to incorporate this standard package, is you can compute the structure of invariant differential algebra with this package, commutator of invariant differential operator, do invariant variational calculus. There is AIDA package by Hubert, which actually computes the structure of differential algebra of invariants. And it has some procedure which is uses RDP procedure. Okay, so that's all.
Questions? Well, thank you very much for coming today. I'll see you tomorrow. Okay, so thank you very much.